President-elect has a big real-life conflict of interest coming into the White House. He is carrying a $300 million loan from Deutsche Bank, a bank which is under investigation by the Justice Department. I want to talk about that with CNN's senior legal analyst, Jeffrey Toobin, and with Jane Fox, staff writer with Vanity Fair, and economics reporter Patrick Gillespie from CNN Money. Emily, I want to start with you. Emily's becoming a regular on the show because you do these great pieces on this. You wrote a piece today, and it's about this Deutsche Bank issue about Donald Trump. You said it's worth hundreds of millions of dollars that could lead to some, this could lead to very thorny problems. This is a quote from you. You said, if the matters aren't settled by the time Trump is sworn in, which would seem unlikely, then the investigation into the bank that Trump has personally guaranteed outstanding loans will be overseen by a Trump-appointed attorney general. What can you tell us about that, Emily?
Well, actually, tonight, Deutsche Bank settled some of its issues with the Justice Department, but there are still issues outstanding. So Donald Trump owes $300 million to Deutsche Bank for various properties, including the new Trump Hotel in D.C. Deutsche Bank happens to be under investigation by the Justice Department. So when Donald Trump appoints an attorney general, that attorney general will be tasked with dealing with those regulatory issues. It's not a good look for a president who owes $300 million to a bank is being, you know, castigated by a political appointee. That is a major conflict of interest.
Jeffrey Toobin?
It's a total conflict of interest. I mean, it's just so obvious. I mean, if the Justice Department is either going to be tough with Deutsche Bank or they're going to be easy with Deutsche Bank. And there is no way for anyone to say, well, it has nothing to do with a $300 million loan. It may well have nothing to do with a $300 million loan, but the whole idea of conflict of interest is that the appearance of conflicting interests, renders any decision suspect. That's why presidents have had, in the modern era, blind trust, so that their personal financial interest cannot be bound up with what the government does.
CNN Money has been writing about these conflict of interest as well. What has been the response from the Trump campaign? Have you gotten any from them regarding this?
They've said that they're going to do their best to avoid conflicts of interest, to really flush out as much as they can, but we haven't really received those details
yet.
What they're saying and doing, are they saying something different? What is concerning is that we're seeing over and over with each new pick a new conflict of interest. You have Wilbur Ross, the Commerce Secretary, who has investments in U.S. steel, and he could be putting tariffs on Chinese steel. That would be a big conflict
of interest. And Carl Icahn, who is the new regulatory czar, owns, among many other things, an oil refinery that's publicly traded. As soon as he was named head of regulations, the stock went up. Because they thought, oh, the regulations are going to go away. Well, oil companies, oil refineries don't like environmental regulations. I mean, these are obvious and egregious conflicts.
Meaning the country, what have we gotten ourselves into here? What's going on?
Well, I mean, I think, with at least some of the cabinet appointees, there are laws about what they must disclose and how they must deal with their conflicts. The president, and this is an important point to make, the president is not covered by these rules. So it's only a political problem for the president. It's not a legal problem.
But some of these things have to be taken care of before the things that he's got to be before
no,
the 20th. No,
well,
not even his business, not even the business part of it.
I mean, under the law, he could have two desks in the Oval Office, one for president, the other for the Trump, Trump organization. I mean, legally, there is no requirement that he divest, but, it is a political problem when the whole world can see that he has all these business interests that are affected by what he does as president.
It raises so many questions about how he's going to deal, how diplomacy will deal with the administration, the business. Are foreign diplomats going to feel pressure to stay at the Trump Hotel in D.C.? Will companies feel that they need to, peddle interests with his commerce secretary, with his state treasury pick, Rex Tillerson? He has major investments in Russia. Is that going to influence his decision making? Are these leaders going to affect, are they going to use their new power to use that for decision making that'll benefit the American people or deepen their own pockets?
Speaking of business interests, Corey Lewandowski, Donald Trump's original campaign manager, just set up shop as a Washington consultant. In other words, he put his relationship with Donald Trump up for sale. Lewandowski promises, and this is a quote from him, "I will not be a swamp creature," but what can you... What else can you call him?
Well, I mean, the drain the swamp has become sort of a joke. I mean, Also, when you think about how much Donald Trump criticized Hillary Clinton for the pay-to-play situation, that, you know, people paid, you know, they contributed to the Clinton Foundation and sought meetings with the State Department, which they didn't get. Now we have situations like Ms. McMahon, who gave millions of dollars to Donald Trump's foundation, getting appointed head of the Small Business Administration. We have other campaign contributors and big money people getting apparent rewards. I mean, it does seem like pay to play.
It's not really draining the swamp, is it? From just listening to our conversation, it sounds more like the Wizard of Oz.
It's
like what's going on behind the curtain?
A big cannonball off a diving board into the swamp more than draining the swamp.
Simple as that. All right. More to come with this panel next. Don't go anywhere. Back with my panel now, Jeffrey Toobin, Emily Jane Fox, and Patrick Gillespie. Okay, so this was an awkward moment. Remember this when Newt Gingrich said drain the swamp was off the table. Now listen.
I want to report that I made a big boo-boo. I talked this morning with President-elect Donald Trump, and he reminded me. He likes draining the swamp. I mischaracterized it the other day. I'm going to be straightforward and tell you, I blew that one. Draining the swamp is in. President-elect Trump wants to do it. And you're going to get to be part of it.
Given our conversation, everything that we have been talking about, what exactly does drain the swamp mean at this point? Do you have any idea?
Getting rid of Democrats. I think that's what it means. I mean, I think it means that his people will be in charge and anyone associated with Barack Obama or the Democratic Party will be out. And I mean, I'm not being facetious. I think that's what it means.
Emily, do you?
I think it may be meaningless at this point because the definition seems to have shifted, but to them, I think it just means anyone who's not on Team Trump. And whether that's a Democrat or not, I think it's anyone who's appointed by Donald Trump or supported by Donald Trump or who supports Donald Trump,
whether
not in the swamp.
Whether they are more or less qualified than his supporter.
Part of it, I think, is getting rid of some institutional norms. Trump's pick for labor secretary has criticized the way that the Labor Department calculates the unemployment rate. So I think it's about shaking things up, not only personnel-wise, but also, you know, action and policy-wise as well.
Patrick, I want to take a look at the editorial. This is an editorial from the Washington Post. It's about Donald Trump and the impact these conflicts of interest could have. And it says, his grand art of the deal philosophy may have been wonderful in real estate, but in public life, he will be held to a high standard. In order to satisfy that and retain public trust, he cannot leave the back door of the White House ajar for influence peddlers. Will he ever announce a plan for separating his presidency from his business interests?
Well, we're waiting for him to come forward on that. You know, he keeps pushing back.
That means so far you don't think so.
So far we haven't heard so.
Yeah.
He had a press conference that was scheduled in December. That got pushed back into January, and at the time, you know, the clock's ticking. Inauguration's January 20th.
Is this going to be like the tax returns that never happened?
Yeah, tax returns. You know, there's a famous New Yorker cartoon with the guy on the phone looking at his calendar, and he says, how's never? Is never good for you? and I think that's about where the tax returns are.
Yeah. Well, I mean, but the plan to separate these, or will we ever see a clear separation?
He said we're going to see a plan, but, you know, the clock is ticking. He's going to be president in a month.
Yeah.
You know, I think they'll come out with something. Yeah. Remember, he was also going to have a press conference. He hasn't had a press conference in July either.
A major press conference
to talk about this.
Yeah, he'll say that the separation. I would imagine the separation will be his children, but his children are still Trump's.
Well, he's already said that. In fairness, he's tweeted that. He's been saying that for months that his children were going to take.
Is that a real separation?
No. There's no question. That's not a blind trust.
I apologize, because
one of his advisors.
But I think, you know, what he will say and what he has said is everybody knew when they were voting for me that I was not going to completely divorce my family from the Trump organization. So I ran on this platform, deal with it. Mm. You know, everybody knew I'm not changing. I think that's the real position.
So these conflicts of interest, This problem, it happens for just about every president. Maybe not to this extent because he has such a big business. Even Jimmy Carter sold his peanut farm back in the 1970s when Antonin Scalia was a White House lawyer. He wrote a memo about the legal angle for Gerald Ford. Scalia acknowledged then that the rules didn't cover the president. But here's his advice. He said, failure to observe these standards will furnish a simple basis for damaging criticism, whether or not they technically apply. Would Donald Trump be smart to listen to that?
I mean, his position is, my business is too complicated to sell. Jimmy Carter could sell his peanut farm.
No, my business is really what it is.
Well, it is, but yeah. But he's just not going to sell. I mean, yes, that is the solution to the problem. The Trump Organization could simply put itself up for bid, sell itself for $1 billion, $2 billion, whatever it's worth, and then they could take that money and put it in a blind trust. That would solve this problem completely. But they're not going
to
do it.
If they were going to do that, he would have done that by now. And he's shown no indication that he has any intention of doing that.
Yeah. He really hates wind turbines, apparently, because the Huffington Post reports that he sent more than a dozen letters to Scotland's top minister lobbying him to kill a plan to put a wind farm offshore from a Trump golf resort. In one letter, Trump wrote this. He said, "You seem hell-bent on destroying Scotland's coastlines and therefore Scotland itself. I will never be on board with this insanity." So soon he's going to be President Trump. He's going to use the force of his office to keep windmills away from his golf club?
Well, it's hard to say exactly what he will do as president, but he took a meeting with people who could lobby for this 2 weeks after he won the election. So regardless of what he does, there is an appearance of being able to use his office as advancing his business interest, and the appearance of that is enough to be a problem. Whether or not it actually happens, it's even more problematic.
But is it really? Go ahead.
Scotland, you know, I understand that they might have not a lot of interest in listening to his claims. Now, he promised lots of jobs at that golf course, and they haven't really come. Far fewer jobs have been created at that golf course than he promised. So there isn't necessarily as much of an incentive, I think, on their part to listen to him after they've had quite a negative experience with the golf course there.
It seems that a lot of what we have been discussing here, you said his appearance, right? You said because as president, he could have two desks. Do you think he really cares about appearance?
Not enough to do anything about it. I think you're right, is that he has decided that it is worth keeping his business interests and getting the criticism.
What does this say? What does it say to you that the business means so much when you are now leader of the free world, which is, you know, unarguably a more important position to have?
It means he cares deeply about his business. And in his mind, or at least for public consumption, he's saying, I'm concentrating fully on the job of president of the United States. It's my kids who are going to be doing
it. Doesn't
the
say the money means more than the service to the country.
I don't think, in fairness, that's exactly what it means.
Mm-hmm. Just asking. Go.
He's a man who's averse to change. He flies home from campaign stops to sleep in his own bed. So I think he's 70 years old. He's been running this business for decades. It's no wonder he's having a hard time giving it up.
Thank you very much. Coming up, a mother calls police after a man allegedly assaults her son, but she winds up getting arrested, and it was all caught on tape.